morning and welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church. We're so delighted that all of you are here to worship with us, and especially if you're a visitor, we are very grateful you're here and hope that you will experience the love and the warmth of the Lord Jesus as you worship with us today, a part of our family. This evening, you'll notice there's already some timpanis and other stuff getting ready for our evensong services tonight. They're at 4:30 and 6:30. They're identical services, and it's a great opportunity to come down and hear the beautiful music and to hear the scriptures read as we have our evensongs, lessons, and carols. So that's 4:30 and 6:30 tonight. Come and join us for that. Just to remind you again of the Christmas services that are approaching. On Christmas Eve, we have a service at 4 p.m. and 6 p.m. And Christmas Day, there's one service at 10 o'clock a.m. And then to remind you that if you're able, this week we host the community prayer breakfast on December 13th over in the depot. And it's a community-wide prayer gathering. And we're inviting members of First Presbyterian Church to join as we host every year during the Christmas season. I think that's all I have for you this morning. I'd just like you to ask you now to prepare your hearts for worship.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of our dear Savior.
News is the Savior has been born to us, and God has called us to celebrate that fact. Let's respond with these words in this call to worship. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation will commend your works to another. They will tell of your mighty acts. They will speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works. They will tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your great deeds. They will celebrate your abundant goodness and joyfully sing of your righteousness. The Lord be with you
and with your spirit.
Let us worship God. Thank you.
greet you again on this happy morning. We thank you for your presence with us, risen Lord Jesus, by the power of the Spirit. And we thank you for the Advent, which means that you came to bring us love and joy and peace and forgiveness and reconciliation with God and with one another. Your gifts are so great, O God. Would you use this service, we pray, to make us ready for the next Advent, when you will come again to reign forever and ever and ever. Make each heart ready for that day. May they experience today your love and your forgiveness again and know how beautiful and wonderful you are. We pray it in Jesus' name. And God's people said together, Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
The first Advent candle represents hope. That hope that has been realized because of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The second Advent candle represents peace that only Christ can bring. The third Advent candle stands for God's gift of love that was demonstrated through sending his Son. Jesus shows us God's perfect love. He is God's love in human form. The Apostle God writes, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Again, we read 1 John, "How great is the love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. By this, the love God was manifested for us, that God sent his only begotten Son into the world, so that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be sacrificed for our sins. Beloved is God. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another." We light this candle today to remind us of how God, in his love, sent his Son as our Savior and Lord.
These words from Luke chapter 2 for our gospel lesson. When the angels had left the shepherds and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God stands forever.
Sacraments are sermons in picture form. That God has been merciful enough to us not just to speak words to us, but to give us these graphic, objective confirmations that his word is true. The message this day, the sermon today, is about God's entrusting us with the word of the gospel, the message of the gospel. He dignifies us with the privilege of going forth like the shepherds and spreading the good news. We're celebrating that in this baptism too, that these parents are privileged not only to know the good news themselves, but to give it away and to give it to their children, to preach and teach and live the gospel in front of them from their earliest days. And we are given the same privilege. And we say often that we are equipping these little ones to be very dangerous for the kingdom of God. It's a little hard to believe that with these sweet little girls. It was easier in the first service. They were all boys, and all the families were with boys. They're playing with the fire and the microphone and so forth. We said, yeah, they're going to be dangerous. They're already dangerous. But we are equipping these little girls to be dangerous too, for the kingdom of God, taking the good news to those in need of it, and spreading the good news throughout the world, advancing against the gates of the kingdom of hell. What a privilege we have to celebrate this gospel, and what a privilege we have to share this gospel with these little ones as they grow up before us. I'm going to ask their parents to come join me to their left, to my left, and their elders to join me to my right, please. Hubbards and Mobleys, would you please repeat these vows before God and before your covenant family? Do you believe in one God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit? And do you confess Jesus Christ to be your personal Lord and Savior? Do you? Do you believe that although our children are conceived and born sinners and therefore subject to the miseries of the fall, yet Christ calls them holy because of their relationship to you as members of his church? Do you? Do you believe God's covenant promise to be your God and the God of your children, and thus present your children for covenant baptism as a sign and seal of their reception into the covenant family of God? Do you?
We do.
You promise with the help of God to bring up your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, to pray for them and with them, and to make every effort so to order your own lives before these little ones that you would not cause them to stumble. Do you? And do you promise to encourage them as soon as they're able to comprehend its significance, to profess their own faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and become active members of Christ's church, following faithfully in her fellowship? Do you?
We do.
Elder Grandpa Hubbard, would you please pray?
Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace and your mercy and your love for us. We thank you also for these little children. We ask, Father, that as they grow in strength and in stature, that you also increase their knowledge of you and your word. We also pray, Father, that they increase their knowledge of you and your word. But, Father, we pray for the parents as well. We pray that as you guide them with your wisdom, as they love and teach their children to be a part of your covenant family. And we pray for this congregation, we pray for this body of believers, that you remind us of our covenant responsibilities toward the rearing of these children. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Shepherds, would you come take your lambs? And Grandpa, tell her you'll give her whatever she wants. Members of First Presbyterian Church, Do you receive these little ones as infant members of your covenant family? Do you promise to surround them with your love? Do you promise to pray for them? Do you promise to set before them such a life of genuine Christian faith and virtue that they might early in life know the reality of personal salvation and rich fellowship in the kingdom of God? If you can answer so from your hearts, answer amen. What name is given this child?
Elsie Windsor.
Elsie Windsor, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh.
Eleanor Christina, child of the covenant, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Elder Boudreau, would you pray for these children?
Thank you, Father, for these children. Thank you for the miracle of birth.
We sort of take it for granted so many times, Father, but maybe not with one of these. And we're just thankful for your safe birth and their growth. And Father, we thank you for the miracle of the new birth. And we don't want to take that for granted. We pray that they would both come to know you as Lord and Savior. And Father, we pray that family around them, their parents, those of us in the congregation, that we would be ones that encourage them in that and challenge them in following you and knowing you as Lord and Savior. And Father, we pray especially for all in these two families that as the verse we just sang, come let us adore him, that would be true for them and true for these children. In Jesus' name, amen.
Heavenly Father has invited us to come into his presence like little children, understanding our need of him and our need of cleansing for sin. I invite you now to kneel if you're able as we confess our sins together. Would you join me now in this corporate confession of sin? O promised Christ, we are a world at war. Our peace depends on your coming. We are a sinful people. Our pardon depends on your coming. We are full of good intentions, but weak at keeping promises. Our only hope of doing God's will is that you should come and help us do it. Lord Christ, Word made flesh, our world waits for your peace, for your pardon, and for your grace. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Brothers and sisters, it's by grace you've been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. It's in that confidence that we stand. Would you stand as we continue to pray?
Our Father, we thank you for this family that you have called together, called the church, of brothers and sisters, fathers and mothers, and children in the body of Christ. We come lifting up one another's concerns and ask that you would give what each of these beloved members of our household stands in need of. We pray today, Father, for Libby Salvador, who suffered a serious break yesterday and is in need of emergent surgery today. Would you please bless her and her girls with all they stand in need of in the weeks ahead as they manage their schoolwork and her work and her recovery. We pray, Lord, for Mary and Sylvester Brown in the loss of, as they grieve the loss of their son this past week, and ask that you would make them a bright shining light of the hope of the resurrection to their family as they gather to mourn. We pray for Jay Gassaway as he prepares to be deployed into dangerous places, as are others in our congregation. We pray that you would comfort him and comfort his family and cause the hope of the gospel to shine forth powerfully through him. Give him a peace and give his family a peace that passes all comprehension. We pray for you to continue to comfort John Phelan in his grief over the loss, the unexpected loss of his father. And after the service yesterday, we pray for journeying mercies for everyone going back to their respective places. Would help John as he has to handle many details following this death too. We pray, Lord, for this gospel that is our strength, that is our rod and our staff, even in the valley of the shadow, that this gospel would be made known clearly through us to our neighbors, to our co-workers, to our city, to our country, to our world. We ask, O Lord, that you would use us to declare the good news of Christ to those around us by word and deed, that they might glorify our Father in heaven. Would you use us as a church throughout the country, the Church of Jesus Christ, to bring healing and peace after such a dissentious season? Lord, show the gospel to be the only power sufficient to reconcile warring parties. And then, Lord, we pray for this good news as it goes into all the world. And we pray today for Victor and Jennifer Gutierrez ministering on the university campuses in Houston and reaching Hispanics as well as international students. And ask, O Lord, that you would continue to give fruit to their labors, continue to use them to draw many to Christ, and strengthen them also to be dangerous servants for the kingdom of God, bringing life and light to those who are in the devil's dominion. Lord, we thank you that we pray all of these things in the strong name of Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Please be seated. Please pass the fellowship pad down your pew.
Bleak midwinter, a stable place of fire.
and sisters in Christ, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's rise and pass that peace to one another. Let's continue to worship together.
Please turn with me in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 4. We're studying through the book of Exodus, and in this Advent season, we've slowed down a little bit to show the relationship between these early chapters of Exodus to the early chapters of the Gospels. In other words, as the hope of Israel's release from Egypt is being born, it finds parallel with the birth of our Savior in the New Testament. That those words that are carried out literally and objectively in the Old Testament are seen in the person of Christ and spiritually in the New Testament. And it shouldn't strike us as strange that there would be these parallels, that there would be this connection, because we know that God is the author of all history. He's the author of redemptive history. And we also say quite often that the Bible is one story, just unfolding over time and repeated thematically over and over again. In fact, we see the same pattern that we talk about often repeated in Exodus 4 and carried out in this entrusting the shepherds with the message to carry to the world. Thus, that theme is that God exposes our need for redemption. God supplies our need for redemption with Christ, and our response to that supply is always thankful obedience. So here in Exodus, as well as in the New Testament, we find the world is in need of a liberating message. God supplies that liberating message through His messengers, and we respond in gratitude for having received that message by giving it away. It's just that simple. That's the parallel we see. Let's look at it in Exodus 4. You keep the passage in mind that John Franks read earlier from Luke chapter 2. and see the relationship, and I pray it gives you fresh motivation for giving away the good news of Jesus Christ. Let's look at Exodus chapter 4, beginning in verse 14. Then the Lord's anger burned. Remember, Moses was protesting, I can't go back to Egypt. I can't do this. I can't do that. I can't speak very well. And to that, God says, the Lord's anger burned against Moses. And he said, what about your brother Aaron, the Levite? I know he can speak well. He's already on his way to meet you, and his heart will be glad when he sees you. You shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. And then look at verse 26. The Lord said to Aaron, go into the desert to meet Moses. So he met Moses at the mountain of God and kissed him. Then Moses told Aaron everything the Lord had sent him to say, and also about all the miraculous signs he had commanded him to perform. Brothers and sisters, this is the very word of God. Thanks be to you, O God. Let's pray together. Lord, would you open our eyes to see wonderful things about the good news of the gospel you've entrusted to us to give away, that we would see it in this very passage and its parallel in Luke chapter 2. We pray that we would not just see it, but you would stir our hearts to give it away, to say something, to speak into the lives around us and share the good news of the liberating gospel of Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray it. And God's people said, amen. This year, just before Thanksgiving, I became aware of some new helplines and help advice that were being made available to people who might find themselves in a crisis at Thanksgiving. You know, there are the traditional ones, like what do you do when you burn your turkey? How do you cook the turkey? How do you deal with the emotional fallout from burning the turkey and so forth? Those are the traditional helplines. But there were new ones this year that were politically driven. And they offered talking points for those who found themselves in controversial conversations at the table. And if you ran out of things to say, you could secretly send out a text and say, I need data for this, and they would feed you the information and you could win the argument. And one of those was not a helpline, but a help column that I found in the Huffington Post. The title of it goes this way. How to talk to your climate change denying relatives this Thanksgiving. Yes, you can. She goes on to give advice for how to convince your relatives who may not be concerned about global warming. Here are some points. You should make it personal. You should talk about the personal threat. You should talk about the dangers that are coming and what they stand to lose if they don't wake up to that fact. Now, I don't know whether global warming is a real phenomenon or not. I leave that to the scientists, and there's no Christian perspective on it. I leave you to decide that. What I want you to see, however, is the intentionality of this column. Now, we know that as Christians, we are to be stewards of God's creation. No question about that. We also know that the world is going to end with global warming. It's just going to be instantaneous, not gradual. But you see the intentionality of this conversation born out of perhaps a worldview that sees this world as all there is. And it should awaken us to the same but greater urgency. That we have a message that is better news. There is worse news than global warming coming. There is the worst news of the end of the world and the judgment to come. There is the worst news that people are being spiritually drained and destroyed and oppressed by the evil one. And we have a message that can set them free. And just as this sincere person advises intentionality in discussions because she's concerned that people's lives are at stake, we should be concerned that people's souls are at stake and we have the message that they need. We learned last week by looking at the parallel between Moses taking the people out of Egypt and Jesus going back into Egypt and retracing those steps in order to fulfill all righteousness, we learned that the righteousness that he is passing on to us, the benefits of salvation he's given to us, is that we find release from our physical captivity to a fallen creation. And we find power to engage in the spiritual conflict that characterizes this present world. And we, if we are submitted to Christ, have the prospect of conquest over the devil's kingdom and eternal life to follow. That's the word that we have the privilege of giving away, and I want you to be reminded of it this morning. First of all, this good news of release from the physical captivity of a fallen creation. Just think what Moses and now Aaron have the privilege of saying. Moses said, I can't share this message on my own. I'm intimidated by Pharaoh, whatever his other excuses are. God says, I'll come alongside you. I'll meet your need. I'll bring Aaron to you. He's the silver-tongued brother, and he will go with you, and you will be like my mouth to him. I will give you words. You put those words in his mouth. He will speak them, and through those words, I will set my people free. Now remember why we learned earlier in our study why God said, Moses, you have to go. He said, because Pharaoh is enslaving those people. It's not just that he's enslaving the Israelites, but he's enslaving those who are image bearers of God. And God said, I will not tolerate that. God is saying through Moses and Aaron, I am concerned for their bodies as well as their souls. He says through the gifting of Christ to us who came in a body, I'm concerned about raising your body from the dead. I'm concerned about giving life and flourishing to your body in this world as well as your soul. And he entrusts us with a message that provides physical, material comfort for image bearers of God in this world. Now, it's not permanent. It's not universal. But when image bearers are enabled to flourish because of the gospel in their lives that does holistic good, it gives testimony to that permanent and perfect kingdom that is coming. And Jesus said, I am entrusting you with that gospel. Jesus said in Luke chapter 4 when he announced his coming, part of my mission is to declare release to the captives. And then he entrusted his disciples and he has entrusted us to speak that word of liberation. What a privilege. Who are we that we should share in the joy of breaking cyclical poverty? Who are we to share in the joy, as we learned last week from our deacons, the joy of breaking cyclical poverty by helping with short-term needs that leads to long-term ability? Breaking cyclical poverty by providing a car, or through our programs that help people who had never been able to own a house to own their own home. Who are we that God should entrust that to us? How satisfying is it, those of you involved in the medical arts, to use your skills with a person who's made in the image of God and to see that person made well? What an incredible privilege. Once a month we have, when after the evening service, we invite people to come forward, we anoint them with oil, we lay hands on them, we pray for God to heal them, and God heals many. How Christ-like is it, those of you who put your lives in danger by stepping into troubled situations where women are being abused or children are being abused or women and children are being trafficked, and you provide safe haven for them, even though it could cost you your life. How Christ-like is that? What an incredible word we have when we're able to say someone who is feeling shamed for their unemployment or shamed because of credit card debt, and we're able to say, you must not feel shamed. You must know that you're made in the image of God, and here, out of that dignity, you can work toward, we can help you work toward independence from those shackles. What a joy it is to teach a kid to read and open them to new worlds. What it is like to pray for somebody who's bedridden with depression, to share with them promises of the gospel that make them well. That's all part of the gospel message that God could preach directly. He doesn't have to put it through you and me, through a bumbling group of servants like we are, but he shares his joy with us by including us in this wonderful ministry of preaching and applying a gospel that sets people free from the physical captivity and hopelessness of a fallen creation. You have been given a word of hope to preach to those, to share with those who are in captivity. Secondly, I want you to think about the power of the word that Christ has entrusted to you to set people free, to empower people in spiritual conflict. Remember, when Moses and Aaron are commissioned to go to Egypt, they are confronting a man, a Pharaoh, who says he is God. And he has his whole nation under his dominion and has convinced them that he is God. And we learned when we were studying that those earlier chapters that the Bible itself reveals that Pharaoh and Egypt at the time were under the control of demonic powers. In fact, in Numbers chapter 33, Moses is reflecting on the release of the people of Israel, and he says, remember, when I brought you out of Egypt, I defeated their gods. When I brought you out of Egypt, I defeated their gods. Egypt, Pharaoh, they were under the direct control of Satan. And so when God sent Moses and Aaron, they were not only confronting someone who was using cheap labor, they were confronting someone who was under the dominion of powerful demons. And their word, because it was empowered by a good news God, their word conquered those false gods, conquered those demons, and released those people from that captivity. You are entrusted with an equally powerful message. You are entrusted with a message so powerful. Jesus said when he sent his disciples, you remember, we sent those 70 on the missionary journey, and they were preaching the arrival of the kingdom of God, the good news of Jesus Christ. And he said, I beheld Satan falling from heaven. That gospel that those 70 bumbling disciples were preaching was so powerful, not because they are, but the message is so powerful that the devil's power to inflict consciences, his power to do terror in the earth was being restricted, and it was visibly displayed to Christ, who said that message is going to be the ultimate undoing of Satan himself. You've been entrusted with that message. Do you realize how relevant that message is in our culture now? You know, the millennials who are, it's that group of people, and we have the largest percentage, the largest demographic of our congregation are millennials, those who have come to adulthood in the early 2000s. And it's such a large group of citizens, be 25% of our population, that everyone is studying them. to figure out how to talk to their kids and figure out how to lead a new employee workforce and how to market to millennials. I think it's one of the most exciting times to be a pastor in the church, the millennial generation, because you give me hope for the church. In fact, the worldview of millennials is so refreshing and so radically different from previous generations that one scholar named John Seale is calling it the New Copernican Revolution. And here is the difference. The previous generations have imbibed the teachings of the Enlightenment, which basically said it's a closed system. We only know what we can know rationally, only that which can be proven objectively and by scientific experimentation is reality and truth. There is no such thing as spiritual reality, no such thing as miracles, no such thing as demons or angels or even a personal Christ. Now, even in the church, we figured out ways to divide those realities. And when we're at church, we think spiritually. And when we're in the rest of our lives, we're thinking secularly. Millennials have had for them, largely through postmodernism and their college professors, they've had that dividing wall broken down. And they're open to all spiritual realities. And so it's back to what C.S. Lewis said. C.S. Lewis said that the early Christian church had more in common with paganism than it does with the post-Christian generation. That is, we have more in common with those who believe that there are multiple gods and demons than we do with those who are complete secularists and say there is no God. Evangelism is a lot more fun, for one. No longer do I have to convince somebody that there is a spiritual world and then that there's a God and then that he sent his son Christ. You just start with, oh yeah, I believe there's a spiritual world. Now, is there good news for those of us in the previous generation who are cynical and living in a closed system and worried if this globe falls apart, we don't have anything left? There is hope, of course, because that's spiritual dominion too. The devil is just as happy with your secularism, with your closed system, as he is with too much worry about demons. And so the gospel we have is a gospel that is powerful enough to break open one's worldview and introduce them to a Christ who is Lord over heaven and earth. But here is the way evangelism goes with a millennial, or a high schooler for that matter. You believe that it's like Paul's conversation in Athens, recorded in Corinthians, not Athens, Georgia, Athens, Greece. Paul's conversation in Athens, when he said, I see that you're a very religious people. Yes, we are. I see that you have numerous gods. Yes. And I see that you have one idol to the unknown God. Well, do you know that I'm sent here by God to introduce you to the unknown God? His name is Jesus Christ. He's come into this world. He's taken on flesh. He died for our sins and he was raised to life. That is the one you're missing. That's the one you've been looking for. He is the one who can shield you from all of the evils of all of these other capricious gods and spiritual powers. He is the one who can set you free from your shame and from your guilt. He is the one who can rule all over all reality for you. John Seale says that in dealing with the millennial generation, we have to be confident in our gospel, that it has the answers for the questions they are asking, which are outside. The answers have to come from outside this world. The questions are too big to be answered by their parents' political systems or by the stale teachings, what they take of the stale teachings of liberal theology of the past. They are asking these kinds of questions, John Seale said. They're asking, how do I relate to my LGBTQ neighbor, friend, relative, whom I love? Or they're asking, how do I date without acting on the assumptions of the hookup scene? And how do I deal with aspirations of good life portrayed in Hollywood films and in television advertising? How do I avoid the soft narcissism of the self-esteem, selfie-saturated culture? How do I deal with my parents' stale politics, which leave me cold? How do I deal with police abuse? How do I deal with high-profile hypocrisy of Christian leaders on Ashley Madison and the longing for romance on The Bachelor and The Bachelorette? This gnawing sense of irrelevance of the church in this age and my Christian belief, how do I deal with that? The devil's answer is, the devil's so-called gospel is this: you can't deal with it. There is nothing in your Christian world, in your Christian worldview, to deal with it. You just have to give in to it. You're on a different side of history. You have to give in to the new definitions of marriage and sexuality, and you have to give in to the medications that are offered to you for dealing therapeutically with your sense of helplessness. You have to give in to the hookup culture. You have to give in to what the world says is romance, and it comes on and off, and it's nothing that lasts really. You have to give in to it. We have better news than that. We have better news than that. We have the news of the Lord Christ, who says, I have empowered you with weapons that are more powerful than the enemy's. I came to give you not only relief in this present life and this world that you can see, but I have given you power to confront demons. The demons that are afflicting you and your culture. I am the one who will rule and reign until I make all of those enemies my footstool. You have that message that brings peace in a spiritually disturbed age. It is good news for those who are physically captive to a fallen creation. It's good news to those who are spiritually conflicted in a spiritually confused age. And it is good news that you have, that you and I, as servants of Jesus Christ, will be on the winning side of the conquest, that death does not have to have the last word, but it will be possible to live after life, to live after death. But here is what we must remember, that as we are engaged in this activity that we call evangelism, that it is characterized by, it must be compelled by love. We have a message that offers hope, we have a message that offers peace, and we have a message that conquers because it is love. We have a message of love that is so powerful that the Bible says it actually advances history. Do you remember that from 2 Peter? Peter says, by living out, by speaking forth the gospel, you may speed the day of his coming. I have no idea how that works. I have no idea how it is that God knows the day and time set for the end of the world, and yet he says, I am including you in my work in such a way that you can speed up the coming of that day by living and practicing the gospel. I have no idea how those two relate. That's for an infinite mind, not a finite mind, but I do know it means this. It means that God is so loving that he wants his house to be full. He wants his house to be full of an innumerable host. And so he incentivizes us to hasten the day of his coming by rounding up more and more who will benefit from his eternal banquet of grace in heaven. We have a powerful message of love. It's not always popular. It's not always what someone wants to hear. It's not always politically correct. It can result in your persecution. It can result in your shunning. It can result of your getting fired. But that opposition to it only proves the more how threatening it is to the devil's kingdom, because he has no message as great and as powerful as the love of Christ. I saw this kind of interaction recently with a debate that occurred online after Jen Hatmaker published her view that she believes that same-sex marriage is a holy relationship. Jen Hatmaker is looked up to by women all around the country as the ideal homemaker, the ideal decorator, cook, and so forth, and an outspoken Christian. And I believe that in a clumsy way, she's trying to say, I am not going to shun those who are homosexuals or who have homosexual attraction. I want to reach out to them in love. But in reaching out to them in love, she didn't know how to reach out without compromising the beauty of the definition of marriage as defined in the gospel. Now, there were lots of very unfair and tacky things that were said in response to Jen Hatmaker that do not reflect the essence of Christianity. But there was one response that went as viral and perhaps more viral than Jen Hatmaker's comments. And it was a personal response by Rosaria Butterfield. Rosaria Butterfield was a tenured English professor at Syracuse and professor of homosexual studies. She was in a same-sex relationship and she was an aggressive homosexual activist. But Presbyterian pastor named Ken Smith in her town, he and his wife reached out to her and said, we just want to get to know you. She was all loaded for bear. She knew it was going to be another mentally impaired evangelical Christian that she was going to sit across from. And she was surprised to find that they were intelligent and they were loving. And over the course of 2 years, she said, the Smiths just loved me. They didn't press the four spiritual laws down my throat. They didn't even invite me to church because they knew it would have been too much for me. But they welcomed me into their home. And they had meals with me. And they loved me. And they answered my questions without defensiveness. So then she responds to Jen Hatmaker. If this were 1999... the year she was converted. If this were 1999, the year I was converted and walked away from the woman and lesbian community I loved instead of 2016, Jen Hatmaker's words about the holiness of LGBT relationships would have flooded into my world like a balm of Gilead. I would have thought, yes, I can have Jesus and my girlfriend. Yes, I can flourish both in my tenured academic discipline and in my church. Maybe I wouldn't need to lose everything to have Jesus. Maybe the gospel wouldn't ruin me while I waited for the Lord to build me back up after he convicted me of my sin and I suffered the consequences. Today I hear Jen's words and a thin trickle of sweat creeps down my back. If I still were in the thick of the battle over the indwelling sin of lesbian desire, Jen's words would have put a millstone around my neck. To be clear, I was not converted out of homosexuality. I was converted out of unbelief. I didn't swap a lifestyle. I died to a life I loved. Conversion to Christ made me face the question squarely. Did my lesbianism reflect who I am? Or did my lesbianism distort who I am through the fall of Adam? I learned the good news. She learned the better news. A homosexual person who struggles with homosexual desires, as a number of you do is no worse sinner than anyone else. But one who may think that their sexuality or gender confusion is a power that can only be given into, as you might be tempted to think about any one of your sins. And the better news is that the message of the love of Jesus Christ is more powerful than anything else, any other power, any other force that hates you. You have the privilege of sharing that message. It sets the prisoner free. I read this week about a World War II hero named Jacob DeShazer. He flew with Jimmy Doolittle, and he had to land his plane unexpectedly behind enemy lines because of a mix-up in the communications, and he was promptly arrested and taken to a prison camp. He was tortured in that prison camp relentlessly for 2 years, mostly in solitary confinement, and he grew to hate his captors. Eventually, the warden decided to expand the offerings of rations and so forth, and even to share a Bible, but just one Bible for the whole camp. That meant that Jacob DeShazer had to wait 6 months to lay his eyes on Scripture. He wasn't a Christian, but he was desperate to read something. 6 months into waiting, he finally received a copy of God's Word. He read it ravenously, and he came finally to Romans chapter 10, and he read, "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved." He confessed Jesus Christ. He believed in his heart. He was saved, and he began to experience behavioral change even in solitary confinement. He experienced the ability to smile and return a kind word to his captor, his personal prison guard, even one who treated him like a dog, to the point that that love conquered that prison guard. After he was let free, after the war ended, he went back home. He shared the good news with his wife, and he said, "You know, we have to go back. We have to go to Japan. That country does not know the same good news that reached into my prison cell and gave me liberation and hope. We have to go back and preach that message." This World War II former prisoner of war came back to Japan. As you can imagine, he gathered huge crowds. He just shared his testimony. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people. He planted churches. He led people to Christ. And one day, he got a knock on his door. It was from a man. He met a man named Mitsuo Fushida. Mitsuo Fushida led those 360 planes that bombed Pearl Harbor. Fushida designed those shallow running torpedoes that destroyed the naval fleet. Fushida had done more than anybody else to prepare that attack and make it devastating to the United States. And this is Fushida standing on his doorstep, and Fushida said, "I heard your testimony and I've given my life to Christ. I want to know what I'm supposed to do next." He joined him as an evangelist. Who but God can write such a story? Who but God, with the word of liberation in the gospel, can reach into a cell, a prison cell, and reach a man through one page of Scripture? Who but God can take that man and say, "Because of what I have, I've got to go back into the heart of spiritual enemy territory and preach the good news to those people"? Who but God can write a story that says, "I can take two former enemies and reconcile them and put them on my team, a team that's going to experience conquest, not through hate, but through the love of God in Jesus Christ"? And that's the message He's given to you and to me. What a privilege to give it away. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we stand amazed and ask how it is possible that you should reach any of us with this message. And to reach those perhaps in this place who have never believed it before, and today will be the day of their salvation. And that would be enough. But then to entrust the same message to us and give us the joy of seeing others come to life. Oh Lord, please equip us for that task and send us forth as the good, as the shepherds, not fearing any reprisal, just compelled by love to give away the only good news. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Stretch forth your hands for his blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord turn his countenance towards you and give you his peace. Amen.